The Lord be with you. Welcome one and all to our last service of 2020. Yes. Would it be a bad thing to jump for joy at this point?
No.
All right. Glad that you could join us here this morning. I have no announcements this morning. Anyone else here on our skeleton crew? All right. Have a happy new year. Let us worship God.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I welcome you on behalf of the whole worship team. We have seven of us here making this virtual service possible. And every week we try to make it a little better. And one of these days we'll get it perfect, and by then the pandemic will be over and we can back in the sanctuary. So let us read responsibly the call to worship. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise God in the heights.
All the shining stars praise you, O God, for you commanded and they were created.
Praise the Lord from the earth, young men and women alike, old and young together.
Let everyone praise the name of the Lord, for your glory is above earth and heaven.
Let us worship God. Pray together the prayer of adoration. Eternal God of the covenant, you have clothed your people with the garments of salvation and covered them with the robes of righteousness.
We praise your name for your work of redemption, sending us Jesus as the promise of peace. Hear our rejoicing as we sing hymns of thanksgiving.
Hear our prayers as we give voice to our inmost thoughts. Fill us with the presence of your living spirit and give us wisdom to live in the light of your gifts. Amen. The first hymn is I Dance in the Morning.
And I'll lead you all wherever you may be, and I'll lead you.
if we say we are without sin, then we have deceived ourselves, and the truth is not in our hearts. Therefore, let us come together as one voice and confess our sins before God. Please join me. God of compassion, have mercy upon us as we make our confession. The year is soon spent. What we ought to have done still awaits action, while we commit acts not in accord with your will. We think of ourselves before others. We serve our own needs. We keep for ourselves the gifts of your graciousness. The new life you offer is not yet proclaimed in the land. Forgive us our sins and make us more faithful. Help us to use our time wisely as we follow Christ's way. Amen. Hear Paul's words of assurance. If we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. The death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. In Christ we are forgiven. Amen. Spirit, O God, and prepare our hearts to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our reading today comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 22 through 40. Listen now for the word of our Lord. When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed him and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required of the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my lips and meditations of all of our hearts be ever acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In 5 days, we will face one of our greatest challenges as humans: relearning to write the correct year on our checks. We will have been in 2020 for 366 days, and suddenly we will have to remember to change what has become second nature for us at this point. With any luck, it won't take you nearly as long as it generally takes me. On the whole, it takes about a month for me to truly get over writing down the wrong year. Regardless, with this change comes untold possibilities for those 365 days. We have 365 golden opportunities to improve ourselves, to be the best that we can be, to live into God's calling to us, whatever that calling may be. And generally, we utilize that opportunity through our New Year's resolutions. Every year, I'm at a loss of what to pick as my resolutions, knowing that the only resolutions I've ever succeeded at is to use mouthwash at least once a day and to floss once a day. Outside of that, I've not been the best. But fortunately, I found that the Bible can be helpful in a pinch. And today's reading is no exception to this rule. The reading for today takes place 40 days following Jesus' birth. Although we haven't talked about them just yet, the wise men have already visited Jesus, Mary, Joseph, and left. The shepherds have come and gone. Jesus has been circumcised offstage, therein marking him as a Jew and a member of God's people. Now comes a scene not in a stable in Bethlehem or even in Nazareth, the town that he's raised in, but rather in Jerusalem. Mary and Joseph are bringing Jesus to the temple as is required by the law in Exodus chapter 13, verse 2, and for another ritual as spelled out in the book of Leviticus chapter 12, verses 2 through 5. The former ritual, the one from Exodus, states that the firstborn male of a couple is to be presented at the temple and dedicated to God as a sign of thanksgiving for sparing the firstborns of Israel in Egypt. The other ritual from Leviticus is the law pertaining to ritual cleanliness of women after giving birth. Jesus was a boy, meaning that after giving birth to Jesus, Mary was ritually unclean for 7 days following that birth, and had to go through a blood cleansing ritual for 33 days following those initial 7. Now, had Jesus been born a female, both of those segments would have been doubled. That first segment would have lasted 14 days, and the blood cleansing ritual would have to have gone on for 66 days. So, Mary is going up to the temple at this point to give an offering that she may be declared ritually clean once again. So this is the setup for the scene that plays out in the reading for today. As Mary and Joseph get to Jerusalem, get up to the temple, they're approached by two different people. The first is Simeon, a very devout man who has been told that he will not die until he has seen the Messiah. The other is the prophet Anna, a woman who, though she has been a widow for most of her life up to this point, was in constant prayer and worship of God. Both of them approach Mary, Joseph, and Jesus. They offer thanksgiving and praise to God for this child. They bless the child. And above all else, they recognize this child as being the Messiah. Now, the actions of these two preceding and during this encounter with Jesus, Mary, and Joseph are where we can draw our potential New Year's resolutions. First suggestion that's made, we see in both Simeon and Anna as they see Jesus. Particularly, we can see Jesus in everyone we meet. As I've mentioned before, the people of Israel were anticipating the coming of the Messiah, and they were expecting someone powerful. They were told that this Messiah would save them from the powers that be. And they interpreted those powers as being Rome, not sin or death. So, with that understanding, they thought this Messiah was going to be physically powerful. They believed that he would lead a physical army against Rome, just like a warrior king, and he, as a king, would be physically wealthy. In short, the common conception of what Jesus was going to be was powerful, in every sense of the word. However, that's not the case. Jesus and Mary purchased two turtle doves, which is a substitute spelled out by the law for those who are too poor to buy a sheep for the sacrifice for Mary's ritual cleanliness. So they're not monetarily powerful. Money aside, Joseph does not hold a position recognized as being authoritative as a carpenter. Nor does the Bible tell us that Joseph served any time in the military. Nothing about this couple and their baby indicates that this infant will be some great warrior king sent as a Messiah for God's people. But still, Simeon and Anna recognize that this is the Messiah, the Christ child, even though he is of humble birth. The story is written in a way that it seems to invite us to do much the same, to see Christ in all humans, known and unknown, to love them as Christ loved us, and to see the value of every human life, regardless of life choices or demographics. As theologian Julie Peoples puts it, if we see Christ in everyone, surely we will have seen the Messiah before our deaths. This, however, is only one suggestion given by the text. The second suggestion that this text makes would be patient with God. On the one hand, we have Simeon, who has been told that he will not die until he has seen the Christ child, this Messiah infant who would arrive at an unknown day and an unknown hour. So Simeon could have seen this as meaning one of two things. On the plus side, that he was going to be given the untold opportunity that many in his generation wouldn't get to see the Christ child. On the negative side, he could have seen it as that he is going to have a very long life that just seems to go on and on and on without end as he just anxiously searches for and awaits the coming of this Messiah that he might finally find rest. On the other hand, there is Anna, a prophet who lived with her husband for 7 years before he died. Customarily, girls were married off at a very young age, traditionally 13, 14, 15. So if she is 84 in this story, that means that she has been living as a widow for up to 64 years. We are not told that she has any children, much less sons, meaning that she has either had to live as a beggar or find a way to support herself, something that's not very common in the Bible. That level of hardship could have easily been seen as a punishment, and out of feeling unjustly punished, turned Anna away from the faith. However, neither Simeon nor Anna see their situations as punishments, or in a negative light at all for that matter. Simeon, rather than getting impatient with God about this promise that never seems to be fulfilled, he patiently awaits this child's arrival and rejoices in the promise of getting to meet the Christ child. For Anna, at the loss of her husband before she had any children, we can wager a guess that she wanted an answer to the why me question. And without any immediate answer, she could very well have gotten impatient with God. But she doesn't. She prays without ceasing. She constantly worships in the temple. And she rejoices in the God that she believes with all her heart protects her. Regardless of their situation, both of them are patient with the Lord, letting things happen according to God's will without any fuss. Something we in the modern day aren't the best at. We can buy whatever we want online and have it shipped to us in 2 days. A concept that doesn't really pan out in regards to having our prayers answered. We can pray for a winning lottery ticket or pray that our favorite sports team wins the championship game. We can pray for answers as to why something bad has befallen us. But if we don't get that lottery ticket, our team doesn't win, if we don't get the answers we want, if it doesn't happen as quickly as we want it to happen, if it doesn't happen the way we want it to happen, we all of a sudden start struggling. For Simeon and Anna, though, both had faith enough to believe and know that God will fulfill his promises and care for them through their days. A level of faith that we should seek. In the end, then, as we look back upon this year, we look towards those 365 golden opportunities ahead of us, and as we soak in this story, we find two more resolutions to add to our list: to be patient and to see Christ in everyone. I realize that these are seemingly obvious resolutions, but we as a people are not the best at them. As humans, we separate people into us and them for an untold number of reasons, refusing to see the people that are them as also being children of God, and therein not worthy of our attentions, like those that are in the us category. As humans, in an age of technology that allows us to purchase and view anything we want when we want it, we have grown rather accustomed to having our cake and eating it too. Patience, unfortunately, is a much more rare virtue than it once was. And all of us, myself included, could do well to be more patient with God and with each other. Therefore, as this year rounds itself out and as the new year begins, I invite you all to put serious thought into what you can accomplish with those 365 golden opportunities. Let us pray. Almighty God, another year is coming to an end with a new year with new opportunities just a few days away. As we prepare for the arrival of those new opportunities, we pray for your guidance. Help us to see the Messiah in all your children, seeing all human life as precious and worth cultivating. Where there are barriers, help us as your people to break those barriers, that all might have access to you, your love, and your word. Help us also to be more patient, Lord. Grant that we might recognize your hand at work in the world around us, and grant us contentment to allow things to happen when you call for them. In all that we say, all that we do, and all that we are, help us to live more fully into your callings to us and the teachings Christ gave us. Today, tomorrow, the year to come, and always. Amen.
Thank you.
let us join together in affirming what it is we believe with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we come now to a time of sharing both joys and concerns with one another. A few joys that definitely are worth raising up. First and foremost, the ability and the patience of our worship team to do this. We've had a lot of audiovisual issues and we've persevered. So for a worship team that puts worship above all else, Lord, we praise you. Thanks be to God. Another joy, as many of you are aware, Linda Schaefer is stepping down as our clerk of session as of the end of this year, and our own Ruth Clayton will be stepping in. So first and foremost, for Linda and for her service to this church these many long years, Lord, we praise you. Thanks be to God. And also for Ruth, who will be stepping into the position. Hopefully she knows what she's getting herself into. But for Ruth and for her dedication, her willingness, Lord, we praise you. Thanks be to God. On a similar note, our own Ken Schmutzler and Nancy Werbitsky are stepping down after 6 years serving on the session for a much needed break. So thanks for them, for their service in the various areas on session and on session as a whole. Lord, we praise you. Thanks be to God. And also thanks for both Gloria Eady and for Sue Stilley, who will be stepping into the positions officially in a couple weeks on the 10th when we have our ordination installation service. So for their willingness, their dedication, and hopefully for their endurance, Lord, we praise you. Thanks be to God. There are no concerns to raise at this time beyond just continued prayers for everyone that we have been praying for thus far, for Doug and for Joni, for Don and for Nita, for Doug and Gail as they get through the tail end of COVID, for all those who are sick and mourning, those who are caring for the sick, the injured, and the dying. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Let us pray.
Hear our prayers, O Lord. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Incline thine ear to us and grant us thy peace. Save our sons and daughters. Do you know?
God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we come before you now lifting up both joys and concerns. We thank you for the dedicated service of those who are stepping down as of the end of this year, for Linda, for Ken, for Nancy, for their dedication, for their patience. We thank you for those that are stepping up to the plate in their stead, for Ruth, for Gloria, and for Sue. Thank you for the dedicated service of our worship team as we continue to persevere through all these technical issues and as we continue to try and bring your love, your word, your light to homes far and wide during this time of social distancing. We lift up all of those who are sick, who are injured, that they might find healing. We lift up those who are mourning, those who are seeing loved ones fade before their very eyes. Pray that you might grant them peace, knowing your presence, even now in the darkest of times. We lift up all of our doctors, nurses, social workers, as they continue to work diligently and to care for all those who are sick, injured, and dying. We lift up all the joys and concerns that though they may not have been vocalized, they are still on our hearts. They are still on our minds. And we lift up them up to you through your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now let's join together in our mission statement. Our mission is to proclaim and demonstrate the inclusiveness of God's love to the people of the Ozarks and the needy of the world.
Praise God from above, blessings fall. Praise Him, all creatures in the hall. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host.
Let us pray. Eternal God of redemption, you bless your creation and it springs forth with beauty. You judge your people with righteousness and new life abounds. We bring you now the fruits of our labors. Bless the work of our hands so that what we do reflects the radiance of your love. Fill us with your Holy Spirit so that what we say proclaims to all people the new hope in Jesus Christ. Amen. Now let's join together in our final hymn, number 545. Gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Now may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit be and go with you all. Amen.